some time in. The first one will be really easy for you to find. It's right at the beginning of your Bible. We're going to look at the first couple chapters of Genesis. And so you can turn there if you'd like to. If you have a device that's equipped with the YouVersion app, all of the verses we're going to look at, some of the quotes we're going to share, and some other things will be found on there as well. In 2017, we have decided we're going to be on a journey of discovery, or for some of us, rediscovery of our foundational beliefs, our foundation stones. As the axiom goes, you can't build something that's solid and tall if you don't have a firm foundation on which to build. And so that's why we're revisiting these. For some of you, it's a revisitation. Some of you, it's the first time maybe hearing them. But this is what we believe in and why we believe it, so that we can build everything else on top of this. Let me give you another analogy I heard this week. I read it from a pastor that wrote this in the 1600s. And he said, imagine, if you will, that your grandfather had a piece of land, and at the time that he purchased it, it was surveyed, and all of the boundaries were paced off, and they were all marked with stakes, and everybody knew where the boundaries were. But over the course of time, just due to weather and other things, those stakes rotted away or were washed away, and they were gone. And when your grandfather died, he willed that piece of property to you. But no record could be found anywhere of what the boundaries were on that land. Now, how would you go about trying to determine or make your case in court of where the property lines actually are? Especially if you had a neighbor that, as they were planting their crops, that they slowly just started encroaching over your property and planting more and more crops. They would probably have a better claim in a court of law to that section of land than you would if you can't show a survey, if you can't show the deed and say, here's where the boundaries are. And what this pastor went on to say is that a lot of times in our Christian faith, we forget the expansive boundaries that we have. And Satan is like that neighbor that wants to constantly encroach over our property lines. And he robs us of a lot of our freedom and a lot of our joy, because we're thinking we got to live in this one little area, this one little space, and that's all that we think that we can stake claim to, when in actuality, we've got the deed right here. We've got the survey. We know where the markers are. And we can say, you're on my property. I get to go this far. I have an expansive piece of property that I get to live on and enjoy life. When Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and life abundantly, he didn't mean life constricted to this little plot of land. So whichever analogy that works for you, whether it's building a strong foundation on which we can go up, or whether it's reclaiming some of the property that maybe we've lost, that's what we're doing in these first Sundays of each month through 2017, is rebuilding and making sure that the foundation is solid and knowing where the boundary markers are, so that we can live this expansive life. So we're in April, so we're up to our fourth foundational truth, and it says this. It says that man was created good and upright. However, man, by voluntary transgression, fell and thereby incurred not only physical death, but also spiritual death, which is separation from God. Now, this very first statement, this is one where I think that Satan has encroached on our property a little bit, to say that man was created good and upright. What Satan wants to constantly do, and in fact, his very name, that name Satan, means that he doesn't want so much to tempt you as he wants to try you like a prosecutor. He wants to bring charges against you. And he wants to say that you're not worthy of the things that God wants to give you. So go with me, if you will, maybe you're already there, in Genesis chapter 1. I want us to look at this idea here. Man was created good and upright. Well, we see it in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, when God is creating all that has been created on the sixth day of creation. Verse 27 says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Now, why would God, if he's creating something in his image, how could we possibly think that he created something other than what was good and upright? God created something very good when he made us. That's how we were created. Now, this verse 27 is sandwiched between a couple of verses that also then give us an inclination to what God thought of us. Because not only did he create us in his image, but we were created for a purpose. So look at verses, we're going to look at verse 26 and then we'll jump to verse 28. Verse 26 is God speaking. He said, "Let us make man in our image." Well, we just saw that in verse 27 as well, in our likeness. And now, for what purpose? What was man going to do? "And let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So verse 27 we just read, so that's how God created us. Verse 28, "God blessed them and said, 'Be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground.'" Man was created good and upright, and he was created for a purpose, and that purpose was to take dominion, take supervision, take oversight of all that God created. Now, David, the psalmist, captured this a little bit in Psalm 8, and I kind of imagine, just by these words that he uses here, I kind of imagine it was one of those crystal clear nights, and maybe David was out tending the sheep and just kind of laying back on the hillside, and he looks up in the sky, and you just see more stars than you can count. They didn't have any of the light pollution that we have now, so there was, I mean, it's a pitch black night, and he can see all of these stars twinkling in the sky. And in Psalm 8, he writes, starting in verse 3, he says, "When I consider your heavens," he's looking up at God's creation, "when I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, when I look at all that, then I say this, well, look at me. I'm awfully small." So he says, well, "What is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him?" In the scope of things, how do I even fit in here? But look at what the Holy Spirit then inspired him to write. "You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and you crowned him with glory and honor." Now, just like we read in Genesis, "You made him ruler over the works of your hands, and you put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea." When David almost got lost and saying, "Look, I almost seem insignificant as I look at these heavens, I see the works that you have created. Who am I?" And then he said, "Oh, but I know who I am. I was created a little bit lower than the angels. And I was created, like it says here in this account, in this creation story in Genesis, I was created to rule, have dominion over what you placed there." Now, notice this. Man was given dominion over everything that God created, with one exception. Man was not given dominion over himself. Now, notice this, and I wanted to display it this way. God and man are working together here. God has created everything, and then he's entrusted man. He's given man the stewardship of everything that God's created. Okay? Man is created in God's image for this express purpose of overseeing God's creation. But there was one thing that he's not given dominion over, and that is himself. In Genesis chapter 2, we see in verse number 15, it says, "The Lord God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord commanded the man, 'You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat of it, you will surely die.'" Here's what Oswald Chambers, how he summed this up. Listen to this. "The temptation came to Adam on this line: disobey and you will become as God. Man took dominion over himself and thereby lost his lordship over everything else. So according to the Bible, he says, the disposition of sin is this. It's my claim to my right to myself. That's what sin ultimately is. God said, you have dominion over everything except yourself. And what the sin was is saying, no, I get to call the shots for myself as well. It's my claim to my right to myself. That's what sin is. And when the sin came, what came along with it was the separation between God and man. Man was created good and upright. He was created in God's image. He was given this place just a little lower than the angels and given dominion over everything except himself. But sin said, this is my claim to my right to myself, and that separated God from man. Let's look at the account there in Genesis chapter 3. It says, now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God really say, you must not eat from any tree in the garden? Little side note here. This is still his tactic. This is still, you see when Satan is tempting Jesus in the wilderness, it was kind of the same thing. Did you really think that this is true, what God said? And that's what, did really, does that seem to make sense? Let's think about that for a minute. That really doesn't make sense, does it? Do you really think that that's what God said? It's always been his tactic. It'll always be his tactic. The woman said to the serpent, we may eat from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. Now, Satan changes strategies, and he just goes outright contradiction. You will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. The woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom. So she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Now, Satan was right here when he said that if you disobey God, you will now know good and evil. Sure enough, their eyes were open. But it now was from the standpoint of being evil and remembering that they were good. They were created good and upright, innocent, pure, clear conscience, standing right there in God's presence. They had no fear of being in God's presence because there was nothing to hide from them. But when they sinned, when they disobeyed God, and this sin separated them, they did know good and evil. But it was not from the perspective that Satan tempted them on. It was from the perspective of now they're evil, and they're remembering that they were good. How horrible that feeling must be. And then we start to see the consequences. Verse number 7, then the eyes of both of them were opened and they realized they were naked. That's the first consequence of sin. They realize they've been uncovered. They feel guilt. They feel shame. And so here's how they try to respond to that. They sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Now, you know, if you've been in your garden and you cut a flower, bring it inside, put it in a vase, put some flower food in there even with it. The flower looks good for a while, but we know that the flower is dying. It's been cut off from its source. It's only a matter of time until you begin to see the color drain out of there and the leaves and the petals begin to wither and the petals all fall off. The leaves turn brown. It's just a matter of time. And so look what they did. They cut fig leaves off. As soon as they cut those fig leaves, they're already dying. What they're trying to do to cover their shame and to cover their embarrassment of having sinned against God, cover their nakedness, we've been exposed, is already dying. It's already going to fade away. And that's why when God said, you will die, it wasn't the immediate, like, touching it and it's immediate death. But they had been cut off from the source. They had been separated from God by their sin. And they attempted to cover themselves. The second consequence then is they became fearful of being around God Verse 8, then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, where are you? He tried to hide from God. It's something that people still try to do today. Some people hide from God by just saying, well, there is no God. So like where David was laying there and looking up at the stars and going, wow, God, you made all of this. There are some that look at all that and go, wow, how lucky we are that the gases got together in the right place at the right time and we had this singular event that this Big Bang exploded and all this stuff just miraculously appeared out of nothing. And aren't we lucky? They try to deny God that way. Or they try to hide from him by saying, well, you know, there's probably a lot of different ways to make God happy. You don't have to, you know, there's not like just one God. Or they might hide from themselves by coming up with a checklist. Oh, this will be what makes God happy. You know, if I do my daily good deed, and if I go to church every once in a while, and I help a homeless person, or I drop some money in the offering, or, you know, and they go through this checklist. As long as I do that, that'll be good. That'll keep me, you know, God won't blast me with any lightning bolts. I'll have stayed hidden from him as a result of that. There's a lot of ways that we still try to hide from God today. It was no different from Adam and Eve right at the beginning when they were separated. They tried to hide from God. Then the third thing that we see that they start doing is they don't want to accept responsibility for their sin. So God says to them in verse 11, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? When God asks you a question, your best answer is either yes or no. Not yes, but. And that's what Adam did. Yes, but the woman you put here with me, she gave me some of the fruit of the tree and I ate it. Then the Lord said to the woman, what is this you have done? It's the same thing. Well, the serpent made me do it. The serpent deceived me and I ate. You see, that the difficulty is with accepting responsibility. If we accept responsibility for the sin, if we accept responsibility for creating the gap, then that means that we're also trying to think that we have to accept responsibility for somehow bridging the gap, for somehow making it right. And that's why some people still, you know, have their checklist. Here's how I can make it right. Here's how I can balance the scales. Here's how I can tip things back in my favor. So they never accept full responsibility. They never say, I sinned, I blew it, I was wrong. Yes, God said, did you sin? I can't. Well, she did it first. Well, what about you? Well, I wouldn't have if it hadn't been for the devil. If it hadn't been for, I was set up for this. I couldn't help myself, you know, and never accepting responsibility. But one of the things that stands out to me is, like, with all three of these first things, realizing that they're naked, trying to, and then they say, well, we'll make clothes, or being afraid of God, so let's hide from him, or they're trying to dodge responsibility. But there's one more consequence that the Bible lists in chapter 3, starting in verse number 23, it says that the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken. And he drove the man out. He placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim with a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. This utter, complete separation from God, you can't get to the source of life. There's a flaming sword in the way. And the response here from Adam and Eve is one really of just almost hanging their head or just resigning themselves to their fate, because as the next verses open in chapter 4, it's just kind of like, well, let's start a family, have some children, raise a family, go to work, and just kind of do life. Just, I mean, what else is there for us to do? Get up, work, take care of the kids, take care of the harvest, take care, you know, just, there's nothing else to do. Solomon writes in the book of Ecclesiastes, he said, you know, I tried all of those things, and all of those things, still separated from God, His conclusion was meaningless, meaningless, utterly, totally, completely meaningless. That's what Adam and Eve tried to do. Let's just get busy with doing stuff and maybe we'll forget about this gap. Maybe we'll forget. But you know, Solomon also wrote in that same book of Ecclesiastes, he said, God has placed in the heart of every man eternity. There is a God desire in the heart of everyone. Every one of us is longing for this gap to be gone, for God and man to be somehow reconciled. But in this Genesis 3, as God is talking to them about the consequences for their sin, for their disobedience, there's also this foreshadowing of how this is going to be resolved. The first thing that we see is that their nakedness, they're not going to have to cover themselves anymore with things that are going to die and fade away. Because in verse number 21 of chapter 3, it says, the Lord God, not Adam and Eve, but the Lord God himself, made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. Think about the foreshadowing there of Jesus, an animal that had done nothing wrong, an animal that was completely innocent and blameless, lost its life, shed its blood, so that God could make clothing from them to cover the ones who did sin. The sinless died to cover the nakedness of the sinner, the foreshadowing of what Jesus was going to come to do for us. But we also see in here as well the foreshadowing of Satan's defeat. He says, in verse number 15, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. And this offspring, he says, he will crush your head. Speaking to Satan, he will crush your head. Satan's power is limited. There is an end coming. There is a crushing that is going to ultimately take place. And in hearing this foreshadowing, this is the first time then that Adam actually gives his wife a name. Up until this point, it's just been the woman that's with you or your wife. But in verse 20, it says that Adam named his wife Eve because she would become the mother of all the living. Eve really means life. Adam, in seeing that God was going to cover their nakedness, that he was going to crush Satan, he foresaw the coming of reconciliation. He saw that there was going to be a time that death was going to be conquered, that the separation was going to be, that gap was going to be bridged, that there was going to be a reconciliation that was going to take place between God and man. Now that reconciliation, in order for it to come about, it has to be somebody unique. Job gives us a little window here. Now, even though Job is in kind of the middle of the Bible, most historians believe that Job was probably the first book of the Bible that was written. And Job is in a tough spot. He feels separated from God. He's not sure what's going on here. I don't feel like God's close by. And his friends are around trying to offer him some advice. And they're at the beginning, they're just saying, well, Job, did you blow it somewhere? Think about this. Think about this. And Job's getting frustrated. But listen to what he says. He says, if only there were someone to arbitrate between us. If there was someone to arbitrate between us, to lay his hand upon us both. Now listen to how he describes this person. Someone to remove God's rod from me, so that his terror would frighten me no more. Remember one of the consequences of sin? They were afraid of God. Then I would speak up without fear of him, but as it stands with me, I cannot. Now, I want you to think about this for a second. If you've ever been involved in a negotiation, okay, let's say that, let's just use the labor versus management, okay? There's a negotiation going on. He says, I need an arbitrator. I need a mediator. Now, what kind of mediator is going to be effective? Do you think that the people that are in management are going to want somebody from labor to serve as the mediator? Management's going to say, well, our side's not going to be represented very well here. But if you go over to the labor side, do you think that they want somebody from management that's going to serve as the mediator between them? They're going to say, oh, no way, because he's not looking out for us. He's looking out for the management. We need a unique person, somebody that is acceptable to both of us, somebody that knows both sides. When we're talking about the split between God and man, and when Job is crying out here, I need an arbitrator, I need a mediator, somebody that can lay his hand on both of us, somebody that knows both of us. Where in the world are we going to find somebody that's God and man? Sound familiar? Fully God, fully man, Jesus. Jesus was the only one that would be the acceptable mediator. He's the only one that God could say, you know my heart. He's the only one that man could say, you know my heart. And could stand and mediate. He could, as Job said, he could lay his hand on both of us. And then Job said, then finally, I wouldn't be afraid to be able to speak up because I'd have this mediator that knows how to mediate and how to speak on my behalf. Only Jesus could be the one that could do that. Now, do you remember, David's description of us as men? He said, who am I? Well, okay, I know who I am. You've made me a little bit lower than the angels. Remember that? The writer of Hebrews uses the same phrase, but he's talking about Jesus. See, we see Jesus who was made a little lower than the angels when he took on this human flesh for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. See, he became just like us, wearing this same flesh so that he could be the mediator for us. Never stopped being God. He was still fully God while he was still fully man. And so in the book of Romans, this is how, in Romans chapter 5, how Paul begins to describe what Jesus did for us as this perfect mediator. He says, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, we can't bridge the gap. We can't close it. When we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. See, on the cross, Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, was the one that could bridge the gap. The one that could bring God and man back together. The one that could reconcile them. That we were created, man was created good and upright. Sin separated us and created a gulf that we could never get across. A chasm that was too big, we couldn't even see the other side. But Jesus on the cross bridged the gap and paid for the forgiveness of our sins. The one that was fully God and fully man. The one that fulfilled all of that foreshadowing. The one that came to crush Satan's head. The one that the Bible now says that we are clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Not we came up with the garment ourselves, but God. Just like that animal was sacrificed for the skin for Adam and Eve, God allowed Jesus to be sacrificed so that now we can be clothed in his robe of righteousness. And you talk about reconciliation. This isn't something like Jesus went, well, yeah, okay, fine, here they are, it's done. Look what Jude says as he closes his letter. He says, Jesus is excited about this. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious throne, with his glorious presence, without fault and with great joy. Jesus is bursting with joy that he got to do this for you. That while we were still sinners, while we were still enemies, while we were still separated, while we were completely helpless to bridge the gap, with great joy, Jesus endured the shame of the cross. And now he can present us to his Father and say, look at them. Look at these people that have been forgiven. They look just like me because they're clothed in my righteousness. We've been reconciled to the Father because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. And this is where Satan has encroached for so long and told us, well, yeah, you know, Jesus did that, but you've got some stuff to do too. I mean, come on, you need to start doing this and this and this. You know, do you think, just kind of like with, he said with Eve, do you really think that that's all that there is? I mean, you just pray a prayer and ask God to forgive you of your sins because you put your faith in Jesus? You really think that just like that, God's, do you know how bad your sins are? Do you know how many times you've blown it? And you think just one prayer is going to do it? You got some other things to be doing as well. That's where Satan has encroached. But he says he's able to present you without fault and with great joy because you're clothed in the robe of Jesus, the righteousness of Jesus. So when the Father looks at you, he says, you look just like my Son. You are covered. You are complete in him. I love this quote that I want to share with you. Now, I want to go back, though. Remember, we said that sin was this. Oswald Chambers' definition, sin is my claim to my right to myself. I can do it. It's what I want. It's how I'm going to get there. Now, if that's what the definition of sin is, then the salvation that Jesus paid for, this is what that salvation would be, is turning it completely around. One more quick one. Salvation is God's right to myself because I have surrendered to the reconciling work of Jesus, saying, I can't do it, but Jesus did, and I surrender to that. What he did is enough to cover my sins. I don't have to claim any stake to my right to myself. I just stake my whole claim to what Jesus did on that cross as he bridged the gap. I love this quote from Ann Voskamp. Believers in Christ are seen by God exactly as Christ is seen by God. Let me say that again because I want that to sink in. Believers in Christ are seen by God exactly as Christ is seen by God. Your righteousness has been transferred. His righteousness has been transferred to you, has been imputed to you. You have all of his righteousness. So listen to what she says. Listen how this goes on. I am not the mistakes I have made. I am the righteousness he has made. I am not the plans I have failed. I am the perfectness he has finished. I am not the wrongs I have done. I am the faultlessness he has been. I am not the sins I have chosen. I am chosen by the Beloved regardless of my sins. In Christ, I am chosen, accepted, justified, anointed, sealed, forgiven, redeemed, complete, free. I am Christ's friend, God's child, and the Holy Spirit's home. Amen. Because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. We were created in God's image. Our sin heritage that's been passed on to us from Adam and Eve has separated us from God. We cannot bridge that gap. Only Jesus the mediator that's fully God and fully man can bridge that gap. And so therefore, our salvation only comes by fully resting in what Jesus has done for us. That's where salvation is. So we can't let Satan deceive us into thinking there's something else we need to add to that, or that we're not worthy of the price that Jesus paid. You are worthy of what Jesus did for you. That's how much he loved you. Would you bow your heads with me for just a moment? We're going to serve communion in just a minute. And communion is just a remembrance. That's what Jesus said. When you do this, when you eat this broken bread and you drink this cup, you are remembering what I did for you on the cross, when my body was broken and my blood was spilled. So the way that we serve communion here is, you don't have to be a member of Calvary Assembly of God to partake of communion. But since communion is a remembrance of what Jesus has done in your life, I want to ask you this morning, and I'm not going to belabor this, I'm not going to drag this out, but I don't want to embarrass anybody either. That's why I ask people to have their heads bowed and their eyes closed. If you're here and you say, I've never trusted Jesus, I've never surrendered to him and placed my hope in him, that he is the forgiveness for my sins, I want to be able to pray with you this morning. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Until you surrender to what Jesus did for you on the cross, you are forever separated from God. There is nothing that you have the power to do to bridge the gap. You're naked, you're running from God, you're hiding from God, you're separated from him. It's only by placing your faith and your trust in what Jesus did that that gap can be filled in, that you can be clothed, and you no longer have shame or fear in God's presence. So if you've never prayed a prayer like that to invite Jesus into your life, I just want to pray with you today. So if that's you, if you're here, would you just slip up your hand just quick enough for me to be able to see it? Everybody else has their heads bowed, their eyes closed. It's just going to be just a private moment between you and me and God. Nobody else is going to see it. Just slip your hand up and put it right back down so that I can be able to pray with you. The prayer that you pray is, there's nothing magical about it. It's just a simple accepting of what Jesus did for you. So I'm going to pray a prayer, and I invite you to just pray this along with me, but in your heart, just use your own words. You don't have to repeat the words that I'm saying. You just say these kinds of words to God. He wants to hear from you. God, I realize when I was the least worthy of your love, when I was completely powerless to do anything about my lost position, that's when Jesus came for me. That's when he died on a cross for my sins. That's when the gap was bridged for me. So today I surrender my right to myself. I surrender totally to your right to me, because of what Jesus did on the cross. Restore me, God, back to that place where we're in communion again, where I don't feel separated. I don't feel afraid or ashamed. I don't feel like I have to come up with excuses, but I just know that I'm your child, that I'm the friend of Jesus, and that I'm the home of your Spirit that will take up residence in me. So God, because of my belief in what Jesus did on the cross for me, forgive me of my sins. Reconcile me to you so that I can live with you forever and ever. You guys are going to serve you communion. There's two cups there that are stacked together. Be sure you grab both of those. And then if you would just hold those elements until everybody's been served so we can partake together.
Broken road lives me beyond my fear.
Says on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this, eat this in remembrance of me." We sang that song a little bit earlier today, "When I think about the Lord and all that he's done for me, can't help but shout hallelujah." Before we partake of the bread today, would you just take a moment again and just begin to think about all that Jesus has brought about in your life because of his brokenness that became your wholeness, that became your healing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your salvation. Thank you for your keeping power. Thanks for blessings that you pour out again and again and again. Lord, we thank you for allowing your body to be broken in our place. We thank you for the eternal life that you've given us, not just the hope of heaven when we die, but the eternal life that is within us each and every moment, because our lives have become your home, your presence with us. Thank you, Jesus. We remember what your broken body did for us. We're taking the bread together. The Bible also says that Jesus took the cup and said, this is the new covenant in my blood. The new covenant. Before, just as God sacrificed an innocent animal to take the place of the sin for Adam and Eve, to cover them, there was rituals, there were processes that people had to go through that under the old covenant to be able to find the atonement for their sins. But Jesus said, the new covenant is my sacrifice of blood once for all. Never has to be repeated again. And friends, what that means for us in the new covenant, unlike the old covenant where we had to wait until this particular time and a particular place that we could get there with a particular sacrifice, that the very moment we feel distant now from Jesus, the very moment that we realize maybe we've been listening to the whispers of Satan, or we've been lied to about how he's been encroaching on our land, that very moment we can apply the blood of Jesus to our life, and we can claim our freedom. We can claim our place as God's sons and daughters, not second-class citizens, not people that are left behind, but people that God views just as he views his son Jesus. So maybe this last week, maybe some things have been going on that made you feel distant. Maybe you've listened to the lies of Satan. Maybe it sounded good at first. God, he questioned, did God really say this? No, I don't think that's right. He's whispered to you. He's encroached on some territory that is God's. I pray today, Jesus, that you would bring freedom, that you would silence lies, and that you would speak truth. The truth of what your blood accomplished on the cross once for all. No diminishment in the power and the effectiveness of your blood. Set my friends free, I pray, to enjoy the abundant life that you have for them. Jesus, we remember and we thank you for what your blood did for us on the cross. Partake of the cup together. Thank you, Jesus. Why don't you stand with me this morning? I'd like to ask you to do something that we don't do super often, but we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. We've all been forgiven and set free by what Jesus did for us on the cross. Would you just, the person sitting to your left and right, would you just join hands with them, your brothers and sisters? And as I pray for you, why don't you just silently pray for that one on your left and your right, that God's blessing would be known in their life. God, I pray that your people would live in your abundance, that they would live in the fullness of life that you have paid for them. I pray for my brothers and sisters, my friends, that their territory would not be diminished, would not be encroached upon by the enemy this week, but they would live in the fullness of the knowledge of you, that they would not look at their past because it is covered by the blood of Jesus, but they would look to the present, they would look to the future, that they stand in your presence, Jesus, clothed in your righteousness, no fear, no shame, no nakedness, no attempts on their own to try to bridge the gap, but they stand reconciled to the Father. Let them live in that joy and that strength this week, and let that blessing flow out of their lives everywhere they go, that people would recognize there's something different about their life because of their encounter with you, Jesus. Bless them, I pray, in your mighty name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, friends. I love you. Have a wonderful week. Live in God's blessings this week and share them with some friends, will you?